morning. It's my honor and privilege to welcome you to a BW Education, BW Disrupt, BW Business World Dialogue. Today we are talking to an entrepreneur, co-founder of a firm called Byju's, which I'm sure all of you are aware of. Let me welcome Ms. Divya Gokulnath, co-founder of Byju's, to this conversation. Divya, welcome. And how have been the last 6 months for you, both personally and professionally?
Thank you, Anurag. I think it's been very exciting, very busy. Maybe I can just put that in numbers. We all love numbers here in Byju's. So in the first 4 years since we launched the app, we got 40 million students onto our learning app. But just in the last 4 months, we got 20 million more. So that's close to 50% of the first 4 year base in the last 4 months. So more and more students are actually trying out online learning. Maybe it's their only option today, but I think we can expect a good percentage of them to continue learning online even on the other side of the crisis. I think just like how a lot of us will continue meeting online, we'll conduct these kind of events online. And I think all of us are realizing how productive and efficient this can actually be. So I think the pandemic has changed a lot of things for education, especially. When the lockdown started, UNESCO reports actually suggested that 1.3 billion children were out of schools due to the crisis. That was the point when we opened up our app for free. We also announced free scheduled live classes from our teachers to ensure that students don't miss out on scheduled learning that school actually brings. And, they also have access to good teachers, something that they were missing at that point of time. So teachers on our app itself got together, they started taking classes to ensure a sustained learning schedule for kids. And I think there are two numbers which show that, they're loving it. For one, the engagement on the app, it's gone up to about 100 minutes in each session. And I think more importantly, students are returning to the app every day. And I think overall, we've been able to kind of find the right balance between profitability, engagement, effectiveness. That's very important. And since all of these are annual subscriptions, parents actually won't renew till they see improved learning outcomes. So our renewal rates are as high as 85%. So if you ask me, this is an inflection point for EdTech. What hasn't happened in years, I think it'll happen in, is happening in months, maybe even weeks for a few things. There is a paradigm shift in the mindset of all stakeholders in education, be it students, be it teachers, be it parents, be it schools, who are quickly positively adapting to online learning because of so many benefits that it offers. Students are getting a front row seat for the first time. Teachers are realizing the advantage of using tech tools. They're facing their students for the first time. It was always towards a blackboard. Now everybody looks at each other and learns and teaches. So yes, I think that, and if it's about Byju's, we hastened up a lot of product launches in the last few months, which would benefit students. We introduced new subjects like history, civics, and geography. We launched the product in most of the major regional languages. We also partnered with companies, which of course, I think we all know about, like one is White Hat Junior, because coding is something which is a future skill. And all our recent integrations, it's been about synergies coming together to create better and more impactful learning experiences for students. So that's in a gist, actually. So
they say sometimes, weeks happen in years, and sometimes years and decades happen in weeks. You sound like you achieved what you need to achieve in years and decades in these last 6 months. Divya, tell me, while this is the positive side of the last 6 months, where the number of registrations have gone up, as you shared the numbers, the quality of engagement has gone up, and hopefully the learning outcomes will go up. I have no doubt about that. And I must say that both my children, I bought a Byju's subscription, I think 1.5 years back. Both my children use the Byju's app. So I am a parent that does pay and use for a Byju's app. So I'm sure there are many other parents like me. So these were the positive sides. These were the rainbows. What about the negatives? What are the things that have unsettled you in the last 6 months? What are the things that you'd like to see better?
So if you ask me, what we thought would be a challenge initially was when we, the entire team couldn't come to work. We all had to work from home. We were doing it for the first time. We weren't used to it, frankly. I have never stayed at home after my 3 month maternity break 6 years ago. So it was very, we thought it would be challenging. Of course, the first few weeks getting settled, it was difficult. But, when you think about it today, I think all of us are so efficient. Even though we are in different parts of the country, we're still able to drive what we want to drive. Maybe we're all on this mission together. So I think the teams have been working fabulously. Even though they're apart, they've been doing a great job. So if you ask me, that was one challenge which we thought would be a challenge, but it turned out not to be. And if anything, it's been better, because like I said, we fast-tracked a lot of launches, and we've been able to come out with a lot of our offerings way before we thought that we would actually have. We had planned it. We had planned regional languages. We had planned more subjects. But because of the situation, and because students had kind of almost had a full stop to their learning, we fast-tracked and launched all of it.
Fantastic. You seem like you converted a problem into an opportunity, and I believe sometimes there is divine intervention. You know, the universe helps. So, coming back to entrepreneurship, Divya, the rules for entrepreneurship broadly are the same, but in the last 6 months, what do you think has got added to those rules? What is the new mindset that has caused, so to say, new set of thinking?
Yeah, so if you ask me, see, I believe that startups which are launched during a downturn tend to be far more durable and resilient than those that actually started in a better economic state. Because every economic downturn actually brings about an entrepreneurial boom. So just to give you an example, the last time, because any crisis creates so many challenges, there are enough problems to be solved, there are enough opportunities, scope for new ideas. So 50 unicorns were created globally immediately after the last crisis. So especially in education, so I can talk about education, that technology is, just starting to make an impact. So much more can be done. It's a great sector for those who are thinking of starting up. There is an opportunity across all age groups, be it curricular or co-curricular. There is an opportunity to create tools for teachers to help them teach better, maybe by creating a platform where they teach seamlessly. Something which will help institutions create a blended model of learning which combines the best of offline and online. So I think the long-term potential is much higher than ever before. So pandemic or no pandemic, I think entrepreneurship is about doing things in an insurgent mode. But during a crisis like this, it's very important to take stock of the situation regularly. I think forget about an annual plan. There's no point in even having a monthly plan or weekly plan. A weekly plan or a daily plan is almost the order of the day. I mean, you think about it, right? 5 years back, if somebody asked, what would you be doing 5 years from now? Nobody had the answer in the world, right? So I think it's important for entrepreneurs to figure out if what they're doing is addressing a latent need in society, and that has the potential to create an impact. So the true struggle lies in surviving. Entrepreneurs who are able to recognize that, plan crucial things like capital, product development, human resource, these are the ones which will emerge successful. And I think the most important thing is that a business cannot be driven by the passion to make money. The passion to change society, create an impact, it's far more important. It's also crucial for them to be passionate about the idea. Like, even Baiju says this a lot, don't define your passion, let your passion define it. So.
Thank you. Be specific about it.
Yeah.
It's like a GPS. When you're in the car, you don't say, take me anywhere. You say, take me to, for a mall in Bangalore or whatever.
In the fastest possible way, but...
I get what you're saying. Let me at this point ask you, you rightly said we got to be passionate and very specific about the idea. We got to do our best what we can do now. And we need to have granularity on things and give it your best when you're doing what you're doing. In some way, you're saying what Eckhart Tolle says, the power of now. Do what you can do now and be the best version of yourself. Coming to, you work with Baiju's, who's really the pivot of this company, right? And you, of course, you're a co-founder and you are the pivot of his life, right? So tell us, how does the dynamics between both of you figure out when it comes to the business?
So I think, a big movie notion is that opposites attract. It's promoted a lot on screen. But I think in real life, having like-minded people, both in your team as well as in your life, is a big asset.
Beautiful.
I think, we are driven by the same goal. We're driven by the same passion to impact the lives of students who are learning around the world. So even on a personal level, I think our interests are very alike. So I think that's where it works. There's a lot of respect, and I think that's key for any relationship, be it professional, be it personal. And when we're not working, we love to travel together, and our priorities are very aligned. It's our company, and outside that, it's our son. He's our universe. So I think, you know, when it's all lined up and when you have a lot of respect for each other, a lot of people actually ask us, like, don't you guys fight? And you know, it's just disagreements. There are no fights. And, you know, just have, if you have it aligned, I think it works out, and then it's a positive.
Yeah, these are different points of view. When you're discussing an issue, an idea, a process, there may be different ways that different people approach. That's not a fight. That's not an argument. That's just two different ways of approaching the same issue. And, you know, I think discussions and having diverse points of view always improves the idea. It always improves the process. It always improves a company. And dare I say, it also improves the relationship, because then you know, you get to learn something from the other person that you haven't learned before. So I'm totally with you in your thinking. Divya, today my 16, 17 year old daughter has already won 2 entrepreneurship awards. She became an entrepreneur at 14. So, you know, the age of entrepreneurship is coming down.
Yeah.
Tell us, what are the traits you see in millennials that make you hopeful? But tell us the traits that you see in millennials that they can improve.
So I think, see, our country's biggest asset are our millennials, right? The average age of our country is 29 years. We are the youngest in the world. Now, if you ask me, I think, and even at Byju's, our average age, by the way, is just 24. So, you know, we work a lot with millennials. So we get to see the kind of ideas that they bring. They're very bubbly, full of energy, ready to try out new things, willing to be molded. You know, this kind of flexibility won't come later on. The flexibility that you would see in a millennial. That being said, I think the only something that could, you know, they could work on is something is I think everybody calls this out, is distractions, probably. And that's where I think, you know, defines a successful entrepreneur from the rest of the rest of the world, in a way. So one, I think being agile, that's very, very important. So answering your question, I think the biggest thing that millennials bring to the table is flexibility, being ready to take in inputs and mold themselves, and where they could, work a bit more to, you know, it's always the difference between good and great, right? So to jump from good to great, I think one is being agile. Idea to execution should be lightning fast. So millennials are already hasty. They just want to do things. They're on fire all the time. They want to achieve stuff. And I think that you should never be afraid to positively disrupt yourself. You know, just like I think we did, we were millennials in a way, right? When we started, and we are here today, and we've never been afraid to kind of positively disrupt ourselves. Prior to 2015, we were 100% services. We were 100% offline company. Today, we're 100% product. We're 100% online. We've moved with the times. We've been fixated on our mission, but we've been flexible with its execution. I think that's very, very important. But our aspirations to kind of impact more and more students led us to be brave enough to disrupt ourselves. And I think it's important to be open to ideas, change your business model if that means better delivery of your offering and scale. So I think, for millennials to become entrepreneurs, the leap that they need to take, if they keep in mind these things of A, being agile, 2, being paranoid about numbers, like I started by even giving you 2 numbers, measuring, assessing every little thing. Because being number driven actually helps. You can only improve things which you can actually measure. It takes you a long way. And while we all have life goals, bringing them down into smaller goals, planning your day better, all of these things actually, you know, will drive you to do even better. And I think something that comes to every millennial is that they're anyway not going to be afraid to fail. So, but fail small and win big. So I think these would be the...
Thank you so much, Divya. You know, Divya, talking to you and listening to you, you're a great role model for women and young professionals and, you know, millennials who want to make a mark in the world. You know, what is your view on entrepreneurship for women, for girls, for young millennials who are women? Is it tougher for them? In your case, you could collaborate with your life partner and build what you both have built. But is it tougher for other women? And what's your advice to them?
So I think there are multiple facets which play a role in a woman's life. To first make her enter the corporate world and then help her stay on, so to say, right? Because if you look at the numbers, it's quite dismal, especially around my age where the maximum number of women leave the workforce because of family matters. And it's also because of the notion that men are supposed to take charge while women are supposed to take care. So all of this is actually slowly changing because I think diversity is no more a feminist notion. I think it's also a corporate agenda. And if you ask me what is happening and what is being done to it, I think companies which think about it since inception. So I'll first talk probably about the what an organization can do, and then probably what the support a woman can get from home. So from a corporation point of view, I think if it's thought about consciously from the inception of the company, they should, and it's not thought as an afterthought, it's easier to ensure diversity in an organization, simply because if there is diversity on top, if a company has good representation of women, the balance is usually in place without putting major efforts. So why that happens is, a lot of studies have proven that women are more likely to bring in more women to support them at work. So you also become a role model, right? But that is one thing which is lacking today, because if you go by the numbers, a quarter of the global businesses have no women in senior management roles at all. So this kind of sets up a notion to men and women across the globe that women cannot be there in top roles. At Byju's, that's one thing I think which we've been very consciously doing, being proud of. We have 33% women representation on the board, 50% representation in the top management, 40% representation across all levels. So one, I think most importantly, having a lot of strong women role models on the top will dispel common notions like the whole thing which I was talking about, where women are only supposed to take care, men are the only ones who take charge. And these women on top become a source of inspiration, motivation for young girls to look up to, aspire that they can also do it. And if you actually look at the numbers today, women represent 53% of the graduates, but only 23% of our workforce. And like I said, around mid-30s, we end up losing half of them because of family commitment. So we do need more representation at work. I think, so one is the organization side, but I think there is also a lot which can be done at home, a sense of community to uplift each other. And because every woman takes support, confidence from another woman at home, be it their mother, be it their sister, be it their mother-in-law. And they're actually a reflection of the belief that their family holds in them. And nothing is actually achieved alone. So it's both. It starts at home. So like you said, I'm very lucky to have a founder who supports me. But the belief that I could do something started very early on. I'm the only child of my parents. I'm not even the only girl child. I'm the only child. So I think my parents have encouraged me from day one. My mother's been a massive role model. She was actually working in Doordarshan, and she managed me, and I didn't have any other company other than my parents because I was the only child. So she taught me how it could be done. So she's been my role model.
Thank you so much, Divya. I would love my daughter Prarthna to kind of interact with you and learn from you. The confidence and the clarity of thought that you bring clearly is something that you can rub off on other women and hopefully help them be the best version of themselves and achieve their dreams. Let me shift gears. About 8 weeks back, the new education policy came, which focused on autonomy of institutions, better learning outcomes, focused on new skills, focused on technology and entrepreneurship in a big way. So, Divya, what is your comment on the new education policy, and how is Byju's positioned well to do well in this new way forward?
So the new policy's focus, I think it's on providing students flexibility. It helps furthering digital education. And I think it's very, very timely, considering that it's coming right now where there's a paradigm shift in the mindset of all stakeholders. So the thing about tech-enabled learning is that it's the best way to achieve scale as well as to maintain uniform quality, irrespective of geography or physical infrastructure availability. And why that is true is, if you look at it, we have 260 million school-going children in India, but we still rank low in all major global assessments. And the reason is actually threefold. One is lack of access to high-quality teaching. Two is a one-size-fits-all approach, because learning is driven, it's in big groups, so it cannot be personalized according to the style of every student. And I think three, and most importantly, learning driven by the fear of exams rather than the love for learning. So technology can actually solve most of these problems at scale. For one, with the 70% access to youth towards a smartphone, I think the problem of access is solved, because you can create high quality content in one corner of the country and have students across the country benefit from it. In terms of personalization, I think technology allows you to customize learning according to the style, the size, the pace of learning of each and every student. And I think the third and the most important is, if an education company does it right, if they can, if it's not just about taking offline learning and digitizing it, right? If you can bring in engagement by using interactive lessons, if you can make learning more interesting for a child, then you actually make them a self-learner. So they start learning because they love to learn. So that's one thing which, by promoting digital learning in the national education policy, I think that's one thing which is very timely. Second is that in the policy, there's also a lot of emphasis on creativity and critical thinking. And this will help prepare young students for the jobs, unseen jobs of tomorrow. So for kids entering primary schools today, they say that 65% of the jobs are not even defined. And the future actually calls for people not with a well-filled mind, but with a well-formed mind. And this starts very, very early on. And so, yeah, I would just like to conclude by saying that as the home to the world's largest K-12 population, the universalization of early school education, the push to improve gross enrollment ratio, a renewed focus on life skills, new life skills like coding, this will help create a stronger pipeline of future leaders in India. So, and coming to Byju's, I think we're a very proud homegrown company. We're very Indian. The policies aim to instill a deep-rooted pride in being Indian. Promoting India as an education hub, it resonates with us. And we anyway will continue to work resolutely towards making a mark on the global map. So,
thank you so much, Divya. I agree with most of you what you said. But let me ask you, is the COVID in last 6 months creating a digital divide? Because a lot of schools or parents or students don't have access to connectivity, they don't have access to devices. If I shared the data on government schools, I mean, you'd be aghast. I'm sure you have the data already. So how do we bridge this digital divide?
True, and that's very valid actually, especially right now. But if you think about it, and a lot of people talk about digital divide, in the long term, if you think of what is it, it's much easier to set up internet and provide a device to a student than to set up brick and mortar schools and provide high quality teachers there. So while it is a problem today, I think it's a short term problem. And like I mentioned, 70% of our youth already has access to it as per data 2 to 3 years back. I'm sure the number is getting better year after year after year. Telecom providers are coming up with plans, to literally democratize internet. So with all of that happening, I think if there is any way to bridge this gap, and if anything, technology is creating a level playing field. It will take a little bit more time because there are a lot of, but I think it's much easier to solve this using technology than to solve it without.
Thank you so much. You're saying in due course of time, access will be provided, and technology in the short term may have created a digital divide, but in the medium and long term will help bridge this divide. That's what Divya Gokulnath is saying. Divya, changing gears, EduTech, every company wants to be an EduTech company. There's a mushrooming of EduTech, right? What will separate the boys from men? Or what will separate the girls from women? I've tried to make sure that, I'm not chauvinistic and not just use phrases that are, I'm changing in my designation. I'll call it chairperson and not a chairman, because really, we got to start with ourselves. So tell us, how will this happen? You know, our edutech, how will everybody, you know, every day I get 5 emails from some new edutech company. I remember, I don't want to take the name of another company that raised another $150 million 2 days back. We put them on a cover 3.5 years back saying, you know, these are the future leaders of tomorrow and look at where they are. So clearly as a media company, as a media platform, it's our duty to discover new talent. Having said that, you know, there are too many players not differentiated, not having the right fundamentals, but calling themselves edutech companies. What do you think will separate the, you know, winners from, so to say, I don't want to use the word losers, from winners from who don't do that well?
Yeah, well, there are no losers. There are only people who experiment, fail, and then, you know, fail multiple times till they win big.
Okay, absolutely. So Divya, I keep saying that experience is what you get when you don't get what you want. And a person never fails. It's the idea, project. So you're absolutely, I'm on the same page. In fact, Divya, you know, I keep saying that the only reason we haven't built a product company in a way that you're building is because we only celebrate success. We do not celebrate failure. And there's nothing called failure. It is an experiment. It is an experience. So I'm fully with you in your thinking.
Yeah. So if you ask me, see, there is a rapid rush, right? There is a risk of educational institutions, companies turning to online learning. It's more of a reactive measure. Now, the problem is when it's a reactive measure, you end up delivering a suboptimal learning solution to students. So that's, I think, you know, keeping, especially for an education company, what are the numbers that drive you? You know, if you have engagement of the end user at the core, if you keep effectiveness in mind, that, and that's, these are the two, I think, things, pillars of learning, right? How much is your student liking what you do and how effective is it? These are the two numbers. If you can keep that at the core of your design, when you design it, then I think, the, you know, companies which do that, so that I'm talking about product design and I'm talking about the conceptualization of the product. Okay, so there are multiple levels at which, you know, differentiation can be brought about and separate the great from the good, so to say, if I would like to put it that way. So one would be the way the product is designed and what are the metrics that are kept in mind and what are the outcomes you expect. I think the second thing is, you know, having... And I think I mentioned this when you asked me about, you know, the advice to millennials on how they can be entrepreneurs. One is, you know, you don't define your passion. You don't say, okay, hey, today I'm going to start up for the sake of starting up. You start up because you truly believe that the product you're going to create is going to impact many, many people. It's going to address a need, because that's what technology does, right? What does technology do, especially if you take a sector like education? It can solve, it gives you a multidimensional to problem solve approach to problem solving. It can solve any problem at scale. So you can create an impact with the help of technology, but you need to do it right. Otherwise, it just becomes, like I said, a suboptimal learning solution. You know, you just take a book, you digitize it, but that's of no use. It's ultimately not going to drive engagement from the end user. So I think, you know, so having keeping the core need in mind of the end user, being very passionate about what you're doing, being very resilient, not taking no for an answer, because it's not easy to start up. When you do it, you'll face hundreds of challenges. That's never written about, like you said. You know, what we see are the big wins. Even for us, you know, a lot of people say, hey, where did they come from? Did they, like, you know, just the last few years, there's been so much noise. But the fact is, there's been years, there's almost a decade of toil, effort to make this product happen. The product didn't happen overnight. Like the team which has created the Byju's the learning app, which 64 million children are using today, has not been created in a span of a year or 2 years. There is a lot of effort which has gone in. There is a lot of research which has gone in. We are a core education company. We added media, we added technology to make it interesting, engaging. So I think that is very, very important.
Fantastic. They say it takes many years for the genius to show up. We only look at the successes. We only look at the glow. We don't look at the hard work and the number of years and the continuous kind of, you know, improvement that it takes. And with it come frustrations, We only focus on successes, but there are a lot of small experiences around the way which sometimes can bog you down.
And I think being very number driven, right? Being paranoid about ROI. When we do an ad, when we do a TV ad or anything, we value money. We make sure that we're getting a return on investment. It just doesn't mean that, you get funded on one side. It's not that, when you spend, you need to think and spend. We've always used our funding for further expansion, be it of products, be it to expand our TAM, to get into more geographies and all of that. And having, profitability, making sure that you have your business model is strong. So I think thinking about all of these things, on the product side, on the business side, on the marketing side, all of these, on the customer side, making sure that you're giving the best possible experience to your student. Like I said, making sure that your metrics of engagement are driven and being very closely monitoring all of that. I think that's what will differentiate a good company from a great company.
Fantastic, Divya. I want to ask you, when you see EduTech landscape, what are the kind of opportunities that you are looking at as a company? And there are other opportunities, there are areas, you want to be in the K-12 space, but there may be other areas, right? So what's your vision going forward? What is, clarity also means knowing what you will do and also knowing what you won't do, right? In business, it's also very important to know what you won't do. I mean, you can't be everything to everybody. So tell us, what is the core vision of Byju's? What can we see Byju's doing? And what can we see Byju's kind of not embracing?
Yeah, so our vision and mission has always been to make students love learning. I think we've never moved away from that. It's just that the way we've done it and the kind of technology that we've used to make that happen has been different. We've never really wavered, and like you rightly said, you can't do one thing today, after a year change your plans, want to do something else the next year. So it's always been at the core that we need to make students fall in love with learning, right? And if you look at any of our ad campaigns which we launched in 2015, and even the ones that we've done as recently as a few months back, we have always kept the student in mind. And we've always been on the side of the student, because we understand that if they enjoy what you give them, if they are able to benefit from what you give them, everybody else, that the parents who see them benefit from this kind of learning, they understand what you're trying to do, and then they adapt, to online learning. Because the last 6 months, COVID has brought EdTech into the limelight. But prior to that, it was a very new segment. And we've created models where students try out the product for 15, 20 days. Parents see that they're benefiting from it, and then they go for it. That hasn't actually changed, because even when we were in the offline model, we used to conduct free workshops. Students would benefit from it and then enroll. So having the students on your side, having them understand the benefit that it gives them before they opt in completely, I think these are the things which it's always been part of what we've done. We haven't changed in that. Second is the kind of, we've always been on the side of the student. Third is being very, not being afraid to take big, bold steps. So we've always been open to positive disruption. We stopped our offline classes, which was our bread and butter. We went 100% online. We first experimented with VSAT technology. And then in 2015, we launched our app. And when we launched our app, we stopped our offline classes, because we realized this is a much more sustainable way of...
And the impact is much bigger. The impact, exactly. Because at the core of your offering is the students. So the number of students, what can happen through technology is clearly much more.
Yes. So,
and you're also bringing in the power of focus. Focus on only one thing and make it bigger. So clearly your clarity that we want to offline, right? So fantastic to walk away from something that is working to build something bigger, better on that kind of, foundation is fantastic. Go on.
And I think what has really helped, right? If you ask me why we don't keep changing our thing is our plans, or it's the team is the same. Now, if you look at, you know, that's unsaid a lot, but it holds a lot of value. Having the same founding team to be with you all throughout. You know, there is focus, there is one sense of direction, there is a team spirit which gets built over time. It's almost like a family. So I think that, you know, otherwise the sense of direction will never change when the core group is the same, because it trickles down to several levels, right? So I think that's one thing which has really worked for us and has made us stay fixated on one mission.
Thank you so much, Divya. Divya, I've seen your advertising. Before I acquired Business World, I was lucky enough to build India's number one advertising marketing media platform in exchangeformedia.com and in Impact. And, you know, we saw Shah Rukh Khan, we saw Baijus himself. When will Divya Gokulnath be in the campaign?
I'm there as a teacher.
You're there as a teacher, that's my support. That's a support. But I'm saying, you know, I watched all your ads. So also Atit is very well known to me. He came from Leeward. So I watched all your ads. But you know, in the way, when I talk to you, you're a great brand ambassador for Baijus. You have fantastic clarity and fantastic articulation. So tell us, as we go along, what are the changes we see in the communication that comes out of Baijus?
So, if you ask me, it's branding and communication has been one thing that, you know, we personally do it. In fact, it's all of the marketing things which get decided. We are all of me, Baiju, Mrinal. We all do it together. So I think that's why, you know, you see that kind of difference. It's something that we believe that it's very, very important to get that right. And if you ask me, who's the hero of all our ads, right? So while you say Shah Rukh Khan or Baiju, the hero of our ads are actually the kids. If you look at all the ads that we've actually done, it's the child who stands out as, you know, the winner.
The hero.
Yes. So that's been how it's different. And even when we did our whole jersey campaign, we realized that the most important thing is that we all learn every day. Like we all learn from everybody around us. We learn from everything around us. So the mission of to keep learning was something which resonated a lot with what the brand wants people to do. So because if you look at the way a 3-4-year-old learns today, they learn because of the love for learning. They learn out of curiosity. They ask hundreds of questions that declines over time. And then now, at now when we're all out of school and college, when we pick up a new skill, it's because we want to learn that new skill. So the whole spirit of keep learning is something which is very, very important. And there is no age at which you can stop.
Beautiful. Learning is a lifelong process. You got to learn and unlearn. Both are equally important.
Yes.
And again, keep saying what got you here won't get you there. You got to add some new facets, add on dimensions, add on skills. And what is key about Baijus is also, Baijus told me that the core team that started Baijus is still with Baijus. Tell us, what is the secret of retaining them and making sure that they stay an integral part of the team?
I think it's very easy to start a mission-driven company, especially in education, because you know, education is close to all of us. It's the only way to make it big in life for most of us. So to get people in is actually easy because it's a very mission-driven segment. But to stay mission-driven, now that's key. So it's easy to start a mission-driven company, but it's not easy to stay mission-driven. And I think celebrating intrapreneurship, allowing your team to stand up, take responsibility, take decisions on their own, experiment multiple times, not be afraid to fail. So, and like I said, right, fail small so that you can win big, but be brave enough to fail small. And that happens only when you can give people enough independence to experiment, fail, and then grow again. So I think the team, like I said, right, it's a family. We don't even call it a team. So we do everything together. we work together, we have fun together, our kids play together. So it's you know, they all call themselves Baiju's kids. So it's this, that spirit is there, you know, we all belong to one family. So I think that is something which and when it's right, when that mix is right on the top, you, every level it happens. So it's not just about the core founding team. If you look at the first 100, 200, 300 people who come, attrition is almost minimal. People don't go. It's not, and like I said, right, the segment can draw you, but to stay on, you need to find something more that will drive you to stay. And I think that's something, that is the secret sauce of where we are today.
You know, they say, I used to say, Divya, I'm sure you heard it from your mom, a family that prays together stays together. The new saying is, a family that's on WhatsApp together stays together. But you added a new dimension, Divya. A family whose children play together is together, so to say. Yeah. So it's a beautiful thought, and I understand what you're saying. And I want to shift gears. I want to ask you two more things. Do you think, you know, we all are enamored by a Harvard, a Kellogg, a Yale. Do you think we'll see world-class universities out of India, or world-class educational institutions which are virtual out of India? Do you think that will be possible? And what is your view on the blended or the, you know, mixed model of learning? What is your point of view? So will an educational institution be on the cloud? You don't need a physical institution. What's your view on that?
Yeah, so maybe we should just divide this into two buckets. One is K-12, and then we have the university learning or higher learning. Now, I think it's different because in K-12, the future of learning, I don't think can be only online. It has to be blended. The reason for that is there is a lot of core learning and teaching that can actually happen online, like for subjects like math and science and social studies. But there are a lot of things that cannot be done online, like sports, which is very, very important, especially in the early years. And also very important to learn skills like empathy. It's always an advantage to have people by your side. So for the K-12 segment, which I will talk about first, while the ongoing crisis has led to a massive mindset shift among parents, teachers, students, making online learning a vital part of mainstream learning, I think the future of learning is not 100% online or 100% offline, but it's blended, where the classrooms of tomorrow will have technology at the core, empowering students to cross over from passive to active learning. And I think we'll also see the future will take a leap from the traditional one-to-many approach to a blended one-on-one learning experience. So students will start enjoying learning much, much more. They'll all start getting a front row seat. So all that will start happening. So that is in terms of K-12. But if you look at higher education and you ask me, will we have, you know, world-class universities coming out of India? My answer is, why not? Because you can actually take higher learning completely online, because it's at that point of time, you need to strengthen your skills in core areas, and all of this, and it's happening today, right? Most of our universities, global universities also, have gone completely online. I know it's a necessity today, but it is possible, it is more possible for the higher segment to go towards a pure online model. For the K-12 segment, it shouldn't, because you know, for children, being around other children teaches them a lot of things. I think they're really missing out on being with, especially, you know, children who don't have other children to play with them right now, are missing out on developing their social skills the way they should, which is something that school had actually provided. So it's important that they learn all of that from school and the corridor time. So nothing can replace a child going to school and playing with their friends and learning in the classrooms, learning social skills in the classrooms. But there are a lot of things which can be done better online. And I think a lot of schools are adapting to that quickly. A lot of core subjects are actually moving online.
Divya, because I have two young adult children, one is 12, the other is 16 plus. I can say that, you know, the COVID has been very tough for kids, for children, because they're nestled up in their homes. They haven't had that much human interaction. And dare I say that, you know, you're absolutely right. And I keep saying, as the immersion of technology goes up in learning, in every aspect of our life, the value of human touch will become even more important. It is even more needed, you know, face-to-face human touch. So it is ironical, but that's how it is. Technology can do that much and it does it beautifully, but there is a role. It's never either or. It's a balance of both. You want to strike a balance, I think. For example, we would tell our children they're spending much more screen time than they ever did. But in some way, that screen time also keeps them engaged with their friends, with their communities that they're engaged with. So clearly, you're right in saying there are certain things that technology will do very well, but there is a role for a, you know, a face-to-face, physical, human touch learning, which will never be replaced by technology. This brings me to this question. You know, it is predicted that in 2034, singularity will happen. Machines will be able to mimic or perform as well as the human beings. What is your view? And if it happens earlier than that, are we prepared for it?
So there will be a lot of, I think, mundane day-to-day tasks which can get replaced. But then, which is why it is so much more critical to get the right kind of education early on, right? Because that statistic that 65% of primary school kids, they don't even know what jobs they're going to work in when they graduate. It's, I think the tomorrow's skills call for people, not those who can just write and forget or memorize and forget, not for people who just have a well-filled mind, but it calls for those who have a well-formed mind, where they can, where critical thinking, where interactivity, where collaboration and all of that becomes more and more important. Social skills become more and more important. And I think those things no machine can replace, right? So, and like you said, a human touch is a human touch. So even in the workspace, I'm sure that you know, the value of having people around you, a lot of things which only humans can do because of the kind of skills which they bring in, those things can never get replaced. But the mundane day-to-day tasks, which is almost like which is something which doesn't require I'll say an intellectual interference, those things can get replaced. So the value of a job, the requirements of a job, it's just changing. It's an ever-changing scenario which can happen. And this is again a prediction, right? We don't know how long it's going to take. We don't know when it's going to happen. So what we can do is prepare our children for that. We can instill in them the right kind of values. We can, as parents, we are their first teachers. So we can teach them about what it means to do things in the right way. Because, you know, things like empathy, collaboration, having a controlled aggression, all of these things which is all human nature, is something that will help them.
Controlled aggression.
That's what games teach you. That's what games teach you, right? So, and the biggest example is when you ask me about offline versus online, you can play a FIFA game online, but you can learn your strategies and techniques through your PlayStation. But to feel the pulse of the game, to learn team spirit, to learn, like you said, the word controlled aggression, which you really liked, all of this can happen only on the ground. And this a machine cannot bring, no? This only a human being can.
Thank you so much, Divya. My son, Prasan, who's 12 years old, is a Baiju's learner, also plays soccer. But these days, he's confined to playing it, the FIFA game. And, you know, he's honing his skills. And he's looking forward to getting out and playing a game. I'm sure that will happen. My last two questions to you. One, you did allude to the fact that if somebody asked you 5 years back, 10 years back, where would you be? Whatever you would have said, it would have been theoretical. One doesn't really know. Right? But let me ask that question again. In 5 years, where would Baiju's be? That's my penultimate question.
Whatever we'll be doing, we will be doing something to make children learn better, make them love learning. And we will just be doing it in probably a even better way, because there is, in EdTech, maybe now there are a lot of companies, but when we started, there was no playbook for success. We would have to look at ourselves. We would have to learn. We have to keep our own goals, beat it the next day, and then create new ones again. So I think whatever we will be doing, we would be doing it in a better way. And we would have reached many, many more students. That's always been our aspiration. That's always been our goal. We want to impact many, many more learners globally as well as deeper in India, because even with so many students who are learning with us, we have a long way to go. We're just starting. We always feel we're just starting because there is so much that can be done. There's so much more to do. So,
thank you, Divya. My last question. Is there a bucket list that Divya Gokulnath has? If yes, what is that bucket list?
My bucket list, I've not made one. I'm just, I'm so busy enjoying myself, doing whatever I'm doing, that I don't think there is something that I have yet to do which I've not done. I love traveling, so because it's about absorbing new cultures, learning new things. So that's something that I would love to continue doing once the lockdown is over. But I don't have a bucket list as such. I take every day as it comes. But yes, I do plan my day so that everything, I am able to give time both at home as well as at work.
Thank you. Tomorrow, Divya, is Teacher's Day, right? Is there a message you have for teachers? My parents have been teachers and academicians. I think they're the most sincere people. They nurture other people and only expect the best for other people. So what is your message for teachers?
I think the role of a teacher is very underrated, especially even in our country. So the next to that of a doctor, I would place the highest importance for the teacher. The reason being, while one person can save your life today, saves your lives today, the teacher sets up the future of a human being for tomorrow. So both in their own ways are very, very critical, highly impactful roles, which I think is underrated. And I think we need a lot more teachers coming, freshers coming back to teaching, because we have so many great minds who come out of engineering or medical colleges who should come back and teach. Teaching should be considered as a priority profession. And for those who are teaching, I think this year has been very different, because a lot of people are experimenting with online learning for the first time, and they've actually aced it. Maybe it was challenging in the beginning, but now they've aced it and they're actually seeing the benefits of it. So I want to thank teachers for creating an impact on every child's life. I want them to mentor and inspire many more people and bring them in. So a lot of doctors inspire their children to become doctors, and lawyers inspire their children to become lawyers. Teachers should inspire their children to become teachers, because you're actually changing the future of someone when you actually teach them, and knowledge only doubles when you share it.
Thank you, Divya. It's been a pleasure talking to you. There are two questions, but you answered those questions in some form or the form. Your views on technology during the skill development for employability. Second is from PSN. Great to hear, Divya G. Very clear views. Will Byju's become an education institution or a deemed university to offer online exclusive MBA and other programs? So if you want to take them, one is the impact on skills of education, and second is, will you become a university ever, a Byju's university, offering business school courses or other courses?
So, see, right now we are focused on after-school learning. We are focused on when a child comes back from school, when they are learning on their own, we want to make that experience better. There's so much more to do there. So we are experimenting new things. We are tying up with multiple institutions. We're doing a lot of stuff. So I can't say yes, I can't say no. But anything that is core education is in the pipeline. Anything that will impact students to learn better is in the pipeline. So we are, because education, I think, it's double. Being in EdTech is double impact, right? You do well, you do good. You do good, you do well. So we are here to stay, to continue to create what we do. But we have a long way to go, but I think we are on the right path.
Thank you so much, Divya, for talking to BW Business World, BW Education, and BW Disrupt. I also, as I shared, we are celebrating Teachers Day on Sunday. We have our top education leaders which have come through a jury process chaired by the chairman of AICTE, Professor Anil Saraswathi. We have some exciting talent that we'll showcase that day. A lot of companies that we spotted very early, and you know, there may be possibilities of collaborating for Baijus with them. So really, even Karan Whitehead Jr., you know, is a great opportunity. That on 9th, we have our Young Entrepreneur of the Year Awards, which is Entrepreneur Under 35. So you see, you know, our jury chair, Rajan Anandan, is going to do a keynote, and Karan Bajaj, who I call the man of the moment, thanks to his partnership with Baijus, will also talk to us. So we'd love if Baijus or you would like to be involved with them, and just wanted to share it with you and all the other audience. This content will also go on to the Business World YouTube channel, go on the Business World website and BW Education website, and will go out in both the physical magazines. Back to Divya, your final comment. What is that one thing that you say to yourself every day that keeps you going?
Today is a brand new day. Be the best you can be, so that when you go to sleep, you know that you've done the best that you could do.
Thank you so much, Divya. God bless you. I hope to meet you sometime soon in Bangalore, Delhi, Bombay, wherever. And I hope COVID goes away soon. And I want to say to everyone watching two things. One, this shall too pass. It may take some time. So please don't slacken up just now. Follow social distancing. Wear the mask. Do sanitization of your hands and body parts wherever possible. And last but not the least, don't lose hope. I keep saying, look for the rainbows in the rain. Look for the stars in darkness. So continue to do that. Do your best. As Divya said, take each day as it comes. Give it your best and magic happens. Thank you so much. God bless you. Divya, it's been a pleasure talking to you. And we look forward to more interaction.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.